George, would you come up and help us by telling us how we're going to get this critical job done?
Thank you, Charlie. Let's give our president a round of applause for that inspiring message. I'm not from Brooklyn, but do you all need to stand up and stretch for just 30 seconds, or do you want me to get right into this?
You guys.
See, I didn't even say it right, did I?
Or y'all.
Y'all. Just stand up and stretch. You've been sitting for an hour, and that'll give me a chance just to take all this in, this beautiful sight of 800 and some family members. Now, I don't want to lose you. Just stretch a little bit.
Jimmy. He's my guy, and I love him truly. He's not good looking, heaven knows, but I'm wild about his crazy clothes. He wears tan shoes with pink shoelaces, a polka dot vest, and man, oh man, he wears tan shoes with pink shoelaces and a big Panama with a purple hat band. Deep sea fishing in a submarine. We go to drive-in movies in a limousine. He's got a Port Liberty and a 12-foot yacht.
Okay, is that better?
He's got tan shoes with pink shoelaces, a polka dot.
Let's go ahead and get started. So I was asked on the way up here, are you ready? And I said, ready for what? I'm up here in the midst of 810, 50 family members. Why would I be nervous? But I'm gonna be completely honest with you. Up until recently, you know, our president talked a lot about we are family. You know, we go to the international meetings, we're a big family, 2 million members, a big family. You hear it all the time. But just up until recently, when I heard that, I felt awkward. I felt uncomfortable, and I didn't know why, and I wanted to figure out why is it that I felt that way, and so many of you had this sense of family. What am I missing, and how do I get that? So I did something unusual. I channeled my inner psychiatrist, and I wouldn't recommend this because some weird stuff comes up when you do that. But I went back to my childhood, and what I'm going to describe to you is probably just going to go right over the top of some of you. But I went back to my childhood, and I realized that my concept of this ideal family was acquired the same way that it was for some of you, I hope. But it was this little box up in the front of the living room. It's called a television box. And I want you to picture this thing. I mean, it wasn't a flat screen. The tube actually came out. It's hard to describe. I do remember some things about this, though. The little plastic knob that turned the channel never lasted. It was plastic. It always broke. So we had a pair of pliers. Oh, yeah. And you go up there, and you turn the channel. It was always a clear channel, fuzz, clear. We had three channels. And it was, times were good. You'd change the channel, you'd put the pliers up there on top of the TV where they belong. Right? Until your brother had to fix his bicycle. Didn't put the pliers back on the TV. You couldn't change the, you could not change the channel. I tried. I had tweezers, I had two spoons. You couldn't do it. Well, the old man, he got tired of not being able to turn the channel, so he got a pair of vice grips. And he put those vice grips on there and clamped them on there so tight, none of us kids could get them off. So here's this box in the middle of the room with, you know, it's always impressive with your friends come over and you'd have a wrench hanging out of your TV. But I was laughing about this the other day because I was thinking, you know, some of the fancy people that had money, they had those antenna ears on top of the TV. Not us, no. No. So our TV is in the front of the room, and I would have to go over, and I would open the front door, and I'd reach out, and I was able to grab this galvanized pipe. And with all my strength, I could turn this pipe. I could still see the TV, and I would turn this pipe that's connected to the antenna up above. And you know, that's how you got that really good picture. In the wintertime in Wenatchee, you had to grab a rag or a sock or something because your hand would stick to that post. So anyway, that's where we met. And you can yell out these families if you know who I'm talking about. That's where we met Ward. And we met June. Now Ward, he would come home from work every night. He'd be there before dinner, wearing his suit, his tie, you know, smiling. And then June, you know, she was cleaning the house, she was cooking meals. Absolutely, in a dress, wearing her pearl necklace. And you think about that now, it's kind of creepy, really. But, and they had two kids. They had Wally, the beaver. Who was the weird? Eddie Haskell. Everybody knew an Eddie Haskell. That was an ideal family right there. There was also John and Olivia. This one might be a little tougher. Oh, geez. They lived on a mountain. They all scream good night every night, right? Good night, John boy. Good night, Ma, Pa. Now, my family wasn't like that. We had six kids, two bedrooms, and we yelled at each other at night, but we didn't yell good night, for sure. My family, well, I remember. Let me mention this first. I remember sitting and laying on this really nice shag green carpet, this horribly green-colored carpet, looking at that television box, thinking, man, that is a family. I wish my family was like that. Once a week, they would come into my house and welcome me to their family. But then we also had the Munsters. My family is more like the Munsters, you know, with Grandpa, Eddie. We had the Adams family, and was it Lurch and Cousin It? The Hillbillies? Yeah, my granny, that was my granny, Firecracker. Sometimes I thought my family was like the Flintstones because, you know, that modern-day Stone Age family. I love that show. So thinking about all those and how it didn't really help solve this riddle of, well, why am I missing this sense of family? So I decided I would break down the characteristics of a family, the building blocks, the DNA, and what does it take to make this family? What I came up with are these four or five things. I'll see if I forget one. Families, they argue, they debate, and they fight, right? And that's okay. That's okay. But if somebody from the outside comes in, picks a fight with one of us, you mess with one, you mess with them all, right? That's what families do. They protect each other. That's what members of this union do. We protect one another. Families, they make sacrifices. When you hurt, they hurt. They don't ever want you to be hungry. They don't want you to be sick. But if you're sick, they're going to take care of you. That's what families do. And that's what members of this union do. Families, they mourn. And they celebrate. That's what members of this union do. Families have history. They have shared values. And so do we. These are real strong similarities between families and members of a union. But what really hit home for me, what made it so that it broke down this wall of resistance, this discomfort when I said we're a big family, was this. There is a bond and a connection with families that can't be matched. But it's not just a blood relation that we're talking about here. How many of you have been blessed through adoption? Those individuals, those people, they're not blood relations, but don't you ever say that they are not family. My family, five siblings, six including myself. I lost an older brother to cancer probably 3 or 4 years ago. My only younger brother took his own life when he was 38. I have two sisters, and I will share with you that I'm not the best brother. I haven't seen them in a little while. But I will tell you this. If I saw them tomorrow, I would feel joy. There would be hugs. And it would not take long before we are right back where we left off. Here's the amazing thing to me, and this is it. I feel the same way about so many of you. It could be a year, it could be 2 years, it could be 3 years that we don't see each other. But when I see you, I'm going to feel joy. I'm going to give you a hug. And I know it's not going to take long before we're right back to where we left off. So when our president stands up here and she says, "We are family," I'm okay with that now. I'm proud to be part of this family. And my question to you, are you proud to be part of this family? Are you proud to be part of this family? Can you clap for like 10 more seconds? Thank you. Our president also talked about welcoming these new members to our family. How do we do that? Do we go up there that first day and hand them a form and say, "I don't have a lot of time for you. I need you to sign this for great benefits. You know, you'll be part of a family. We'll see you at that first meeting." That's not how we welcome people to our family. Absolutely not. No, we make a connection with those people. We make an emotional connection with those people. I want to share with you a story. But before I do, I'm going to tell you it might be tough for me to get through this story, and I'm going to tell you why. I have a son. His name is Tyson. When Tyson was 4 or 5 years old, he was helping his grandma cook spaghetti. I wasn't there at the time, but somehow doing this, he lost his balance. His hand went into the boiling water. I got home shortly after. I said, they had his hand under a sink running water over it. I said, "No, to the hospital." For the next 2 weeks, every day, I took Tyson to the doctor to peel that dead skin off. Extremely painful. But we created a bond through this process. And the way we did that was every time he went in, he would get on the doctor's bed, lay down. I would take his little face in my hands, and I would say, "Okay, Tyson, today what transformer do you want?" And he would tell me. I'd say, "Okay, what does this transformer do? What color is it? How does it move? Have you seen the cartoon?" And before you know it, the procedure was over. Now, it cost me a fortune, a transformer every day on a classified school employee's salary. It killed me. We didn't eat. But there was a tremendous bond between Tyson and I. So Tyson is 34 years old, and he's an addict. I still see him. I still hunt him down. He's still a very good individual, but he can't beat this. He's oftentimes homeless. Now to my story. Actually, the pre-story is longer than the story. The story doesn't take very long. I was at a training recently, and a young man was talking, he was facilitating. And the story he told is a story that I could tell, that you could tell. All of us can relate to this story. He said that he was walking out of a store one day. So you can imagine he's, let's say, Safeway. Everybody walks out of Safeway, right? Hagen's. He's walking out of Safeway, and he sees a homeless person on a bench, Tyson. And he does what a lot of us do. He kind of sways to the side a little bit, and he's hoping, I hope, you know, there's no eye contact. I don't want to make eye contact with this person. So he's walking along and he hears this, sir. Keeps walking. Again, he hears, sir. Keeps walking. And one last time, with a little bit of desperation, he hears, sir. And he stopped. And then he kept walking. He tells a story that he went home that day and he just felt like crap. He felt horrible and he didn't know why. Couldn't put his finger on it. So that night, he's looking in the mirror. And he says, it hit me. He says, I did what no human being should ever do to another human being. And that is, I made him feel invisible. We've all felt invisible. I have. We've made other people feel invisible. It is a horrible thing, and we should never do that to another human being. Our president was mentioning that her first day, a lot of times you feel a little lost. I felt invisible my first day at work. I didn't know anybody. Nobody welcomed me. I didn't know what to do. It was a missed opportunity. We cannot do that to our fellow members. We have to go to them. We have to make them understand we are a family and you want to belong to us. They're going to ask three questions. If they ask themselves these three questions and the answer is yes, they'll be part of the family. It is, did they see me? Did they hear me? Did anything I said to them mean anything? Let me tell you something, a little bit of advice from an old guy. When I'm done, don't do it right now, but you text somebody that you really care about, and you say, you know what, from this point forward, I'm going to see you, I'm going to hear you, and everything you say to me is going to matter. When you get home, I promise you they're going to be really happy. I know I did that to my wife, Carmen. It worked. It worked. So we have to make sure those people are welcome into this family. The last thing I want to talk to you about, I'm going to need some help for this, and we got to do this efficiently. I'm going to ask some people to come up here on the stage with me, and this is important. You got to do it quickly because I'm not going to stop talking, and I want you up here before I'm done. That's going to be important, okay? So it's going to be a little disruptive. I want Betty Toops. I want Lynn Myers. People can help these people up. I want all former board members on this stage, presidents included. I want Doug Nelson. I want Jay Webster. Dave Fleming. Tim Bush. Come on up here. Just line up the stage. How are you doing? Pat Zelnick, get up here. Kathy Stewart, Kathleen Brown, Barb Johnson, just come on up here. Keep moving up. There's so many others I could have up on this stage, but this is what I want to talk about. If we keep moving back and make room. So I'm gonna hit you with a cliche. I hate cliches. I don't even know if I'm saying that word right. Is it cliche, cliche? I don't even know. I know they irritate me. But if you know anything about me, when something really irritates me, I try to figure out why. Why is it? So this cliche I know I said it wrong that time. This cliche that I'm gonna share with you is standing on the shoulders of those that came before us. We've all heard it. But have we ever actually thought about it? It actually comes from the 12th century. And the original translation was, discovering truths, building on previous discoveries. Discovering truth, building on the discovery of previous discoveries. Now, what does that mean? It means you're building. It means you're not starting here. You're building on previous discoveries. Isaac Newton said it differently. He said, what did he say? He said, if I see further than others, it is by standing on the shoulders of giants. Right? I want to put a face to the name. Ladies and gentlemen, these are giants of this organization. These and many others. I apologize, there are so many in this room, staff and board, leaders that could be up here. I just wanted to make a point. Another translation is, we are who we are and where we are because of those that came before us. That's a little more simpler. Simpler, that's a word, isn't it? So, I talked about a shared obligation, and this is what that obligation is. We have to accept that this is our time. Right now is our time. We have to make sure, we must make sure that our shoulders are worthy of future generations to stand safely. Our past giants expect that of us, and our future giants depend on that, and we will not let them down. Thank you.